So before I start the session, let me ask you, what do you really want to learn? Your principal may have a perspective on what to teach you, I may have a perspective on what you should know, but ultimately it's you who has to suffer me for the next 1.5 hours. So can you tell me, what do you really want to know? Yeah, what do you really want to learn? Anybody here? I don't know what they've been telling you, but I have no history of meeting, punishing anybody. So you can speak fearlessly in this session. And if you have any questions, you are most welcome to ask and contribute. So what do you really want to know? Can I ask you one?
Your basic mantra will be your success.
Oh, my basic mantra behind success, okay. Yes, what would you like to learn? Why am I asking all the girls? How come the boys are not speaking? And at a time like this, everybody stops making eye contact with me, hoping that I don't catch them. So yes. Yes. Would you like to tell us what would you like to talk about?
Basic etiquettes we should have in school and other places.
Pardon? Basic etiquettes we should have in school and other places. Okay, super. That's a good starting point. Yes, something from this side. Any of the boys? How come the boys in this room are more shy than the girls? Yes? Anybody? No? No? Are you scared of me?
The first question.
would a lawyer are you? How would an engineer or doctor are you? The third question is going to test your soft skills, which is how you jog, how you walk, how you dress, how you behave, and how you conduct yourself. If you were an examiner, how many marks would you like to allocate to the third question? Yes, the two ones in front of you. Are you the Edwards? Okay, yes, Mr. Edwards. 50. 50, yes, the Edgar.
How
come? She's absent. Okay, so please name 50 marks. Yes?
100.
You would like to get, what would other two
It's more important in our life to have more soft skills rather than having intellectual skills.
Okay, that's it was something that's cute. Okay, yes. Yes,
ma'am.
62. 62? Wow, that's very really exacting. Yes. You want to be an accountant or a lawyer?
Chartered
accountant. No, 62. Yes.
15.
15 or 15? 50. Okay. What about those ones in the last row? What about the guy who wants to be in Goa? Yes, sir. How many marks would you like to give?
Well, it depends on what type of question
you have. No, don't go into all that. Just throw a number, you don't need an answer. Reason for
25.
The lady right in the back, last row. Yes, ma'am? 70. Yeah, you answer. Yes. Yeah, any? 1550. 50. Okay, so assuming that, let's be pessimistic. 33% of your success is due to your soft skills and the balance 67% of the pie chart is your technical and intellectual abilities. But the way I look at it is that would you ever leave a 33 mark question to chance? If you want to score in the high 90s, how much do you need on a 33 mark question to go into 90s? Bad news is you need a 30 or a 33 mark question even to get into a 90s. Am I right? So this skill alone is not going to help you. Forward is definitely going to help you get far. In fact, I'm standing in a school currently, but the teachers are not responsible for the academic system. But I do firmly believe that the Indian academic system has completely failed on a couple of parameters. Is that true?
Yes.
When I teach leaders in the corporate world, there are two skills that leaders have in abundance that are never taught in any school or college. Even I train at ISB, I teach at IIM Bangalore. None of those colleges touch upon two skills which are needed in the corporate world. Which are those skills? Yes?
Charisma.
Charisma, yeah, okay. It's a very broad, beautiful word. But let's narrow it down to some skills. Yes? Pardon? Yes, yes, yes. Communication skills. Now, what are the communication skills that you're taught in schools and colleges? Very little, right? What is the second skill which is needed? Like you have the communication. No, I would say public speaking. Is that right?
Yes.
Have you ever met a business or political leader who is lacking in these two skills? So clearly, if you want to get ahead in life, the two skills that are definitely needed are communication skills and public speaking. Now, what are the communication skills that the board tests you on? Think about it. You have that ridiculous 10 mark question for letter writing, am I right? Yeah. You spend the entire length standard. Other than the format. And you also understand that there are only three kinds of letters that they can possibly ask. So you mark those letters also. Then there's another ridiculous question for essay writing. I've been through it, so I like it, so let's not on each other. There's 15 mark question for essay writing. That also you monitor. Am I right? And there are only four kinds of essays they ask. Which are those? Trip to the zoo or beach? Yes, to biography of a successful person. And the fourth one is a fiction genre. You know, they give you a ridiculous statement like unknown performance, dot, dot, dot. And everybody says stay away from that. You know, that can go either way. So stick to descriptive, get your 13 or 15, life looks good. But I can tell you one thing, going forward, as you transition from classroom to a cubicle, and as you go ahead and start interviewing, start projecting yourselves, please understand one thing, there are two skills that you need to focus. The way you communicate and the way you present yourself. I've yet to reach a business or political leader who is lacking in that. I've trained a lot of people who reach the age of 40. They have IIT, Kharagpur, and IIM Hyderabad to back them. But the fact is that they are completely Now the interesting bit is that as a nation, we don't focus on these. Because in fact, just 20 years ago in India, it was considered a minus point to be well dressed. Am I right? Yeah? Serious children were not well dressed. When I was growing up, you were all gloves if you dressed well. If you were really a serious achiever, you didn't dress well. Show that how you were achieving. But I do believe that the way you look, the way you speak, the way you conduct yourself, in today's competitive world, you give it an extra edge. What you call as a competitive edge. Now, what are the skills according to that Indians can upgrade at your level? What do you think are the skills when you interact with people from across or you know the skill to which according to other skills that we lack? Yes?
Confidence.
But confidence is a very broad word. Everything adds to the confidence. So what are the skills?
The way
you present ourselves. Yes, as a nation we uniformly fail on that. What else? Indians speak English very fast. True or false? You know, we speak very fast. Many of the regional languages are spoken fast, like a Tamil, or a Malayalam, or a Punjabi, or a Marathi. It's more than a breakneck speed, so we transfer the same speed to English. But English in class is a very cool, calm, composed language. Now, the interesting bit is that you live in a globalized world. As soon as you step out of the school, you're going to start interacting with people from different parts of this planet. Is that true? Whether it is via email, or it is via phone call, or it is via face-to-face meetings, your interactions are going to go global. So in which case there are multiple ways of interacting with people. One is, if there is one piece of advice I'd like to give you, I would tell you that English is a very important part of this language. When in doubt, switch on BBC. Are you in a hurry to speak fast? No. So when you want to communicate a thought, the one skill that I would like to tell you is, speak in a very formal, calm, composed way. In fact, all trainers, all presenters, all leaders, including Mr. Obama and Hillary Clinton, have been trained on this one skill, that when you speak, 80% of the people should be able to understand what you say. They retain very high-level body language experts to help them project the correct image. So in which case, when you speak, make sure that you speak slowly. You speak in a cool, calm, composed way. And you speak in a way that 80% of people should be able to understand. So don't blurt out your answer. That was great up to 10th standard. But now going forward, how many of you have participated in some kind of a group discussion or in some kind of interview? Yeah, which career is required?
Almost
every career. So now I think 10th standard level or maybe later? Yeah? 12th or later? Could it be after that?
It depends on what you need.
So which career would require after 12th standard interview?
Designing.
So a face-to-face interview?
Yeah.
Yeah, so in which case please make sure you speak in a very cool, calm, composed way. One, it makes you look much more intelligent than you actually are. Can you imagine? You can fake up and upgrade your IQ. Isn't that good? Secondly, you look much more cool and calm and composed. In which case most people can understand what you're saying. So you definitely have an edge. Because most people will go for a meeting even when they are 40 years old and start blurting out the answers at breakneck speed which people can't understand. So one, what is the first message I'm giving you? Speak? Repeat after me. I think I'm used to that. So what is the first message I'm giving you? Speak slowly in a cool, patient style. Thinking. Yeah, intelligent. Children. What are the other challenges we face? Body language? Yeah. Our body language is very controlled. It's a cultural thing. In some cultures, body languages are much more controlled. Which are the cultures where body languages are totally relaxed and chilled and free? Which Western cultures? You all have seen enough movies and television, I'm sure. Which are the cultures where the body language is completely chilled? Yes? African cultures.
African
American. Oh, that's very defining. What other cultures? Yeah? Yeah. You know, I don't know if they've told me, but I'm about 81 years old, so I'm very deaf. I cannot hear because you have to speak loudly. Yes. Which other cultures?
The Jamaican.
Jamaican, so this is about African continent and African culture. What about the US?
What do you mean by free body language?
about it. Now in our culture, it's a very unique culture, but in our culture, what others will think about you is very integral to our culture. Am I right? In the Vedic community, what will people think? Am I right? It's, you know, I don't want to look stupid, I don't want to look ridiculous, I don't want to look embarrassed, it will embarrass me. So in our culture, saving face is a very integral part of the culture. It means what can people think about me if I do this? Now these are the cultures where people don't give a damn what people think about. Which are those cultures? US culture, thank you so much. US culture, Australian culture, Canadian culture, New Zealand culture. Now what's common between all these countries?
Thank you.
Come, I'll teach you how to do this. You know, I'll just attend a workshop. So you've learned all the buzzwords. So you become satellite gurus, right? You want to disperse our young people. I have no problem with that. The best category is something called active listeners. The bad news is there are 80 children. There are only 4 of you who are active listeners. People do not want to listen. Understand what's being spoken. Take in the body language of the way I'm communicating. And in the whole picture, remember it, use it and implement it much later on in life. The rest of you are in some other zone. But that's okay with you, doesn't matter. So, what are the other skills that you can have? Do you feel we are very poor in the first few seconds? You don't know what to say. An average Indian is very poor at conducting small talk. It's not you, but we are even an idea of 50-year-old professionals. We are very poor in the first few seconds. We don't know what to say. We are frozen. But once we get started, then there is no stop button. Doesn't work. So in which case, what are the few things that you can say in the first few seconds? Introduce yourself. Yeah. Now how should you introduce yourself? Okay, so one is of course a good powerful self-introduction clause. Remember there are only 3 elements to a good self-introduction. First of all, full name. Secondly, where you study or where you work. Third is, what is the real work that you do? So I work, I'm in the 12th grade and I'm majoring in whatever. So please go on and speak confidently. Most people introduce themselves like this. I am Sheetala Vatsavakura Jeevan. Do you understand anything? So what is a nice way to introduce yourself? Or some people go into a long monologue without quite realizing. So they say, you know, actually, basically, technically, they start the story from 1995 without quite realizing that that by 2002 are followers. So in which case, please understand that there's a nice way to introduce yourself in this business-like way. So what are the 3 elements of a good self-introduction?
Yeah.
let me make it easy for you. Any word, including your name, your school name, your achievements, any marks, any numbers that you want to focus on, just reduce the screen and increase the volume. So one way of saying is, hi, I'm Chita Kavanagar, I was governor at Kavanagar. Okay, do you understand everything? Or the other way to say is to say, nice meeting you, Shikha Kapadhyaya. I work as a corporate etiquette consultant. Do you understand something? Yes. Oh, so in which case, if you say last year, I managed to get only 94%. But this year has been a little bit. I've managed to get 96%. What am I doing to 94 and 96? Yes. You don't have a yellow marker in your way. So my friend, can you do this once more? With speed ratings.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Aman Rohela, and currently I am in 11th grade and I am studying science in the Global Indian International School in Chittagong.
Was that better? Can you clap for him, please?
My name is...
So now we are going to go to the very easy. We are going to up the game. So now going forward, everybody is going to use speed breakers. Got it? So now we have to start testing your body language. So that's something that we already given you the cheat sheet on. So please use it. Now going forward. Yes.
Good afternoon. My name is Parth Sabharwal. I'm in class 12. I'm a football player.
Oh, sorry. Before I say anything. Was he good? He seems to be popular. Nobody wants to criticize it. Okay. Now we're going to add an extra layer to it, which is body language. So you have got the vocal down back because we now, how does body language communicate confidence? You want to learn confidence, right? Never attend a workshop that teaches you confidence because they're confident. There's nothing more confidence, many things add to the confidence. So, what is body language? How could he polish his body language? How could he upgrade it? Thinking. He was moving. Let me make it very easy to you. When people are given a choice, giving a discipline and seeing, what do they do? But for seeing is mindless, right? It's like a television in the doctor's clinic. Every go to a doctor's clinic, there's a huge TV which is playing. The normal starts all the serials which you may not be watching otherwise. But when you go to the doctor's clinic, you're sick, you're tired, you're stressed, and it's on volume, and you can actually walk past people, and they are mesmerized by that television. Now we also know when it comes to teachers, when you have a, you have not slept, I have done it also. It's like you sleep in the class but with your eyes open. Because that way the teacher cannot catch you. The minute you shut your eyes, you have trouble. So you have to start making excuses like I have a headache. Right? So you can see. Because it's so beautiful to see. But if she catches you, then of course you are in trouble. And then you get up and say, So, if you are given an option, you will choose seeing over listening. So my message to you is that when you really want to create impact, when you want people in the interview, or a meeting, or a group discussion, or anything to focus on what you're saying, keep your body very still. Because that way you're telling the people you have no choice but to focus now on my. Because if you start distracting your audience, then they have a much better chance to focus on what's happening there and not focus on the world. So my friend, you have to stand still and say the same.
Hi, my name is Parth Sabharwal. I'm in class 12, studying science. I go to Global Indian International School and I am a football player.
Super! Was that better? Thank you so much. Can you clap for me?
I said boy.
Okay, so this is your uniform, that's it?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mahatan Kumar and I'm studying in 11th grade from Global Indian International School and I'm studying science. Though it might sound ironic, I'm pursuing a career in journalism.
Why ironic?
Because I'm doing science.
You didn't do anything with anything. Was he what? Can you help him get better? He was?
Fast.
So my friend will have to use those same Hollywood speed breakers and come back and tell us what exactly you want to do. What's
it? Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Adan Kumar. I'm studying in Latin Gate from Global Indian International School. I'm studying science and I'm pursuing a career in journalism.
Super! Now I'm going to give you one tip. Whenever you are doing any kind of conversation or you want to create impact when you talk to people, never speak more than 3 sentences. The way you reduce the volume completely to lip syncing. What happened? Give me volume to the form. Yeah, same form. You don't understand what you're saying. So, my friend, you have to be persistent with this. Also, when you are speaking, create a little graph. It's like acting class. I highly recommend that each of you please enroll for a 1 week acting class. You know why? Because it completely lowers the inhibitions. Otherwise, you are very controlled in the way you speak. Secondly, why are you staring at me? Also teaches you volume. See, there's a really interesting way to create drama. If you want, have you know there's a website called TED Talks YouTube channel? How many of you have visited TED Talks? How many of you have not visited? Do you have a pen pencil? Can you please write on TED, it's very simple, TED Talks. I want you to see TED Talks. I want you to hear world speakers speak on TED Talks. Now what you will notice on TED Talks is that there's a lot of drama getting started. Even if you hear the doctor speak about cancer, or you hear an expert like Amy Curran speak about body types, so that is, they bring a lot of drama. So they raise the whole thing. Sometimes you can feel more drama and lower your voice. Isn't that true? Even with your parents, when your dad calls you in the room and is hysterical and shouts at you, you don't get so scared. But if he calls you to the room and says, just come and talk to you. You get more scared? Yeah.
You'll say, I don't know why I'm doing this. Some of you have called
this very tired woman from Bombay. We would have been better off without her. Which brings me to my next point, which is energy and enthusiasm. How important do you think is that in the way you come here?
Have a wrong impression about
it. Yeah, you know, I have studied about, I've trained about 30,000 Indian professionals, and I can tell you one thing, the only thing common among all the achievements that I've trained is their energy and enthusiasm. The funny thing is, it wasn't like you. In school, you are tested only on one parameter, which is your marks. But as you step into the outside world, you will notice that there are a lot of brilliant children who never made it anyway. And then there are a lot of B and C graders who are very far ahead in life. So what is this formula? Now, psychologists, organization development specialists have all been studying this for years. That's why in the 80s, if you got recruited by a very big company, they used to test your IQ. They gave it a hardcore IQ test. And if they decided that you were in the top decile, you got hired. Then they realized, after tracking those people, that these guys with the greatest IQ somehow never got promoted. So what was that secret? So then they started doing EQ, which is behavioral testing. So they started giving a lot of behavior tests, like how does this guy perform, what does this guy do for this. But then today they have realized that that's also not enough. The number one recipe for seeking, or the secret for success at the task is to elevate yourself. True or false? Please conduct yourself with a lot of energy and enthusiasm, because I always tell people, passion is infectious. Is that true? When you meet somebody who has a lot of energy and enthusiasm for what they are doing, whether you like it or you don't, it may not be a great day for me. But the fact is that I'm only going to see you for 2 hours. If I was to conduct a whole session prop up against this table like this, what would you say about me? Amini, you didn't speak enough. Maybe hangover. What are you that people stand with a lot of energy and enthusiasm. And you have to communicate that passion. Because it's with you to really project yourself to your body and problems. I'm going to take a little break right now and ask you for 3 questions. What are your questions?
How about we discussed so far?
Yes,
sir. Not that type of question. Yeah, it's not that type of question which is asked that often. But I've noticed that I'm the only one who sits like, you know, with one leg on top of the other.
In the way girls sit. And so I just want to ask, is that acceptable or
is that... Is it acceptable? Yes, it is acceptable. If I was to demonstrate on a chair, I would tell you, women sit either with their legs crossed at the knee, or they sit with their legs parallel if they're wearing a pair of trousers. So if they're wearing skirts, they sit with their legs crossed at the knee. Men sit either with their legs parallel, or with their legs crossed to the knee, or with their legs crossed to the ankle. So you can cross your legs to the knee. But having said that, if you really want to communicate a formal appearance, please sit with your legs back. Because that is when your body is giving fats. So you can sit with your legs crossed as long as you don't show the underbelly of your shoes. There's something called the fourth position. You know what is that? When you sit with one leg so heavily crossed that the foot which is on top, you can see the underbelly of the shoe. That is not acceptable, but you can definitely point your foot down and sit. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
It should be better, but please stand with your shoulders straight.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes. Any questions? Yes, yes.
When you are talking about standing still when you are communicating with somebody, I have seen that most CEOs, while presenting a new product, they generally walk around the stage like Elon Musk, Steve Jobs, Satya Nadella, all of these people move around the stage while talking. So,
yeah.
Why do they do that?
You know, they are the epitomes of body language.
If you, I want you to go to TED Talks and please see the Tesla man, and the Apple man, and the Facebook man. They are people who are entrepreneurs who have the highest level of confidence. And I want you to see that body language. That to me is clear. What I'm teaching you is really more over here. Now when you are completely comfortable with yourself and what you are presenting and the product that you are discussing, if you see Steve Jobs, TED Talks video on launching the iPad, right? You will notice that he's parading up and down the stage. Yeah. He's completely comfortable with that product himself. He's completely comfortable with this skill. Now, when you are that level of confidence, you can hurry up enough and no problem. But take baby steps, build it up, and then become extremely confident. So, yes, that is your final goal.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah? Any question? Yes? See, you cannot stand like a statue and deliver a message, because that is also the goal you have for the audience. You have to move around. But when you are going to focus on a number, or a sentence, or a word, that is when you make your language very clear. In fact, for a short person, some of you are very tiny girls over here, I have a suggestion. Please walk around the stage a little bit, because that way, in people's mind, you will take up a lot more space. See, if I start walking from here, and then I deliver some part of the lecture over here, in your mind, actually I have taken up 8 feet of space when I am a smaller person. So you can do that, but when you want to create a message which focuses on your name, a number, a sentence, please keep your body language still. If not clear, it's very good for the audience. Yes. Any questions? Yes.
Now, what was the word for yesterday in Hindi?
expert. That's all. You have multiple chances to do the same thing. Right? So in our culture, where you can carry forward to the next world, what is telling you? It's not a problem. It's the Western world. It's a world that is dictating the way business is going to be done. And I don't see it changing in your lifetime. Forget mine. Next 50 years, when you are going to be working, the Western world is going to dominate the world of business. Can you tell me why? Because we are not competitive, no, we are very competitive. Not punctual, no. Why is the Western world dominating the world of business today? Because? No.
We don't care about the professional stuff.
No. 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 Innovation. We don't innovate as a nation. The Western world has been innovating. All the four names that our friends gave, they're all people who are based in one square kilometer of each other. Am I right? Now there is huge innovation in the Western world. And the bad news is that the country that innovates is the country that's going to dictate business. We may become an outsource, we may become the leader of the world. But in fact, is there no innovation coming out of India? What is the biggest innovation that's come out of India in the last 50 years? That's innovation. If you can come up with Facebook and call the whole world to give up to Facebook and use it, that's innovation. If you can come up with iPhone 6s, that's innovation. Am I right? Now, have we come up with anything in the world that's going crazy over? Don't tell me yoga, because that's 10,000 years old. That was 10,000. And don't tell me the number 0 by Arya Bhatta, because that was also many 10,000 years. So what has been the biggest innovation that's come out of India in the last century?
I know.
Has nobody ever been there before? Is it something so revolutionary that the Western world is looking to buy technology from India?
No. Tata Nano is one of the most revolutionary stuff.
Tata Nano, you know something? I feel that product had a lot of potential, but I don't think that it was delivered to the way it should have. Because it was supposed to replace a motorcycle. Mr. Tata's vision was that there is a family on a cycle, on a motorcycle or a scooter, two children, two parents, four people, and it is unsafe. So he designed a Nano to make sure that every motorcycle rider would go out and buy a Nano. Do you see more motorcycles now or do you see more Nanos? That product will have to be fine-tuned. It's a great product. But yes, it had potential, but it does not maximize its potential. In fact, I firmly believe that the only innovation that's come out of India in the last 50 years is IPL. Indians love cricket. Indians love Bollywood. And Indians love entertainment. Anything cricket and Bollywood and entertainment and combine them together. Indians love it in a 3-hour movie format. Right? So yes, that is innovation. But otherwise, there is no innovation. So in your lifetime, you will have to live in a world. Whether you are a businessman or you are a professional, your world is going to be dictated by the Western world, which means punctuality will become a very essential career skill, because in their world, their entire work day is divided into half an hour slots. 9:30, 10:30. And that's the way they like to deliver. And our culture, we are very relaxed. I always tell people, IST is Indian Structuring Them. 5 minutes will be together. 10 minutes will be together. Right? So in our culture, we are very relaxed. But one skill that each of you will have to upgrade is the ability to deliver goods and services on time. And time management is the third skill that you can work on. If you ask me, there are two classes that you should attend. One is acting and two is time management. What are the other skills that we can upgrade as a country? Look around you. Yeah. Yes. Observe others. We don't observe others. But we are good at gossip. We are constantly talking about others as a nation. Don't you think in India gossip is a national pastime? You know something, it takes me a long time to explain. I mean, I'm sorry. Will you submit this project by Alpha? And that. What is, as teachers and some students that you have tried to get the project by Alpha? No, in our culture, Alpha is equal to N-O. Will you show up for the party on Saturday night? What is maybe? N? In fact, I always tell people in our culture sometimes even yes is a word to say no. See, in our culture somebody says, you know, will you do this for me? You say, chalo, yes, go, but nothing not karo. That's all. So you say, yeah, I'll do that. And then just don't go ahead. So in our culture, yes is also another word to say the word no. In their culture, if they have to handle a problem, they go from point A to point B in the shortest possible time. In our culture, if there's a problem, what is the first reaction? Avoidance. In school level, the teacher says, did you see this while it was happening? You saw it, but you don't want to get into trouble. So what do you say? I was not there. She was handling that class. I was not there. So the best reaction of any situation is to say, I was not there. Even at the national level, when we have put on floods, 5,000 lives are lost. The central government and the state government?
Not at
all. We gave you money to repair. What did you do with the money? The state government tells the municipal corporation, we gave you money to repair. Where's the money? The municipal corporation says, where's the money? We didn't see it. Everybody is chasing the money. 5,000 lives get lost in 48 hours. In our culture, avoidance is the best approach to our cause. See, the best way to wear out any problem is to say, I was not there. I didn't see it. I have made the mistake of joining the committee in our building. And I have taken a very unique portfolio in a mobile building for parking. Now, have you ever been to Mumbai?
Yes.
Yeah. What is the parking situation in every residential building? Dismal. People are constantly fighting for parking. So, we have a very beautiful parking where we have 10 visitors parking. But every time we realize that all our residents were parking in our visitors parking. Overnight, very sneaky. So we had a lot of overnight visitors which we didn't know about. So I took the portfolio, I said, okay, let me try to figure out. The beautiful thing was, every time I asked the watchman, I said, ye to gaadi bolne ki lagti. Madam, I said, aap kahan the jab ye baat hui? Madam, main from India. Every watchman would say, madam, main from toilet. Finally, I called up the security agency. I said, I don't know about security, but one thing is for sure. All your watchmen have huge urinary bladder problems. They are constantly in the toilet. So please send us some healthy guys because they should be more outside than inside. So in our culture, it was the avoidance approach that everybody was taking. Hierarchy. You will notice it in schools. I know a lot of teachers are sitting in this session. And you will also notice it in the workplace. In our culture, we are extremely hierarchical. Is that right? Hierarchy is very well defined. And when somebody pushes down, you don't like to argue back. So that is the way. I was brought up in an Indian school in Mumbai, and then I went to the US for some studies. The biggest shock to me was that in Indian schools, you never correct your teachers. You will not answer back and answer, because I have nothing to do. Then we always had that chemistry teacher who was balancing equations, but always put an extra hydrogen atom on one side. Did you ever correct that teacher? No, because you said, you know, better not. Better not mess with her because she has those 20 marks of practicals in her hand. And then it's going to get very ugly. So everybody stands there smiling. But the calculus teacher with an extra number here, nobody corrected the teacher. What I'm trying to mean that is that in our culture, we're extremely hierarchical. When I moved to the US, the biggest shock to me was that people are constantly arguing with the teacher. So the first few days, one day I got up and said, I'm sorry, I don't agree with you in a very aggressive way. Let's catch up over pizza and discuss further. I was like, oh my god, this guy is inviting for pizza for arguing with the teacher. In India, I would have been standing on the class for the next many days if I had spoken with this level of enthusiasm and aggression. Now, in our culture, we are extremely hierarchical. You will notice this also in the workplace. You will notice this in every situation where there is power. In their culture, days. They mean it. In our culture, when we use first names in the workplaces, let me leave you with no level of illusion, we don't mean it. Time. In their culture, time is fixed. In our culture, time is a nice, stretchable limit. It's okay. What is it here? In a 48 hours, after 10 minutes, their time doesn't matter. Contacts. In their culture, and few people know few people. In our culture, everybody knows everybody. Even if they don't know, they know something about them. You know which neighbor moved in. You know which is his car. You know where he went for a foreign holiday. You know everything about all the children who are playing downstairs. So in our culture, we make it our business to know other people's business. Social setting, in their culture. Few people know few people. In our culture, everybody knows everyone. It's one big party. That's why in the Western world, when people say this era, how many people attended your wedding? Very often I tell them, about 800. They say, oh my God, this era, you know, Mr. Mehra, so well networked, you know, 800 people. Whenever I see my own wedding video, about 750 of them, I don't know who they were. Who are those people? I can't even recognize them. I've never seen them again. They were very embarrassed, very good looking, got a lot of gifts, saved a lot of food, and never found their way back in my life. Any questions? Yes.
So you were saying that US people, they know something, they know only a few people, right? Indians, they know about everyone. So I have to question whether it is good to know everyone or is it kind of bad?
It's good to know. In fact, they are aping us. There's no culture superior to it. I'm not being judgmental because I'm telling Indians, I'm telling the gaps that Indians have in a very short time so that each of you can go on and maximize your potential. But the fact is that our culture is not in any way inferior or superior to any other culture. Every culture has its strengths and weaknesses. Now the good news in our culture is relationship building. In our culture, we build a lot of relationships. Ex-boss, ex-professor, ex-teacher, ex-neighbor. You're constantly in touch with people. Secondly, the good thing in our culture is that they're constantly talking to people. And we have a lot of bonds, family bonds. So first cousin's wedding, second cousin's wedding, you've even attended a third cousin's wedding, I'm sure, right? Now in India, when American girl attended a second cousin's wedding, they even believe it. He said, second cousin, my God, that's very far in the family tree. Now in his culture, he didn't even attend his own brother's wedding. Guess what? He said, you know, I've just joined a job. And within 2 weeks of joining a new job, my brother said that he's getting married. I thought it's so unfair if I apply for leave. So I told my brother, I'll give you a very expensive gift and I'm sorry I can't attend your wedding. Now in India, if you ever tell somebody you can't attend your own brother's wedding, what will the guy do? Resign. He'll be like, I'm out of here, I'm not going to work in this job anymore. Right? So in our culture, we have very deep, good family relationships, lots of families, a lot less loneliness and depression.
They would classify you as a job depending on what you do. And then also, and this is how, you know, it just comes down to the professor, which is the nerd, the highest level, the popular level. So, wouldn't that also be hierarchy?
No, I'll tell you one thing, my friend. Teenage culture is superimposed on any culture. That's one. Secondly, I think the nation is too fast. Is that true? You eat American food, you watch American movies, you watch American TV shows of Big Bang Theory and all those others. Now you really have any other influence besides American movies. When was the last time you saw an Italian or a German movie? Hardly. Right? So in our culture, I feel here, Indian cities have Americanized too fast. That's why we are facing all the problems. So in our culture also, not sure it's good. People have all jobs and needs and many more things. Yes? Yes, any questions? Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. We got married next too fast. So, okay, now most of us are careless. We see most of us are careless and we are more free and we don't need to face this. So, if we go back to the normal society that we're living right now with the average age being 45,
mixed bag. It's very tough to explain India. Right? First of all, there's nobody called an Indian. Sit, sit. There's nobody called an Indian. You are the east, west, north, south, there is no Indian. Can you pick up one guy and say, this is an Indian? No. We look very differently, different food, we dress differently. So one has to learn diversity. That's one problem. Secondly, there are multiple generations working with each other. So you are Gen Z or Gen Y? Yeah? Gen Z. Then there is Gen Y. Then there is Gen X. Then there is baby boomers. So there are multiple generations trying to work with each other. So your parents possibly are Gen X. So in which case, they are understanding what you are doing. There are multiple changes thanks to technology. So yes, it's an interesting time to be in. But having said that, let me make it easy for you. Certain things don't go out of fashion at all. Being polite to people never went out of fashion, am I right? Yeah, across countries, across centuries, across generations. Being nice to people, being kind to people is still in fashion. Is that true?
Yes.
Using full words is also in fashion. Is that true?
Yes.
Yeah? You know, I do a lot of work with young entrepreneurs because I work with private equity companies. So these 30-year-old, you know those startup guys who get like $20 billion and $20 million. Now, I don't even know how many zeros there are in billion and billion after a point. So they come to my office for one-on-one coaching because once somebody is invested in them, then you know media discovers them. But see the beautiful email that this guy wrote to me. So one of those $20 million guys came to my office for a two-hour coaching on how to interact with the media. See the mail the guy sent to me. Can you see? Then I'll give you one suggestion. You have excellent go out and find yourself a publisher. But please don't torture me with 500 words. Tell me the same thing in 3 bullet points. Yes. Subject is not written properly, subject is not changed, subject is not updated. There is no subject. Please put a nice subject which is a mention bracket so that people feel like opening your email. Yes, what else? In a few minutes I will start the booming for you. So few more questions. Yes. Any other things on email? What about mobile manners? What are the top 5 mobile manners that people come in?
Someone else is talking, you use your mobile.
Yeah. When you are speaking to someone else, you are physically taking their time. Please do not text or take time for. What else? Thank you so much. This brings me to the third point. When creating caller tunes and new tunes, Vodafone is a brand of mine that I must say they have a phenomenal revenue model. If they can call children like you to spend 40 rupees on a caller tune and another 40 rupees on a ringtone, am I right? Oh, ridiculous. What is the stupidest ringtone you have ever heard in your life?
Clumsy.
You're clumsy. No attention to detail. Would you like to get updated my doctor who has 5,000 papers on his desk and who has yesterday's cup of coffee and day before's cup of coffee also lying there and a half eaten sandwich from Monday morning. Would you?
No.
So, please understand, you can clean and garden, wear a blazer or a jacket, at the most wear a school uniform, at the least wear a school uniform, keep your hair well cleaned, and this will project a good image. Yes, any questions you have on technology? Can you move on to growing? Yes.
My email, I have a question. Should we put beers or slash now or just put slips also?
Okay, very good question. First of all, it's the word beer has not gone out of fashion. Because in societies like ours, the word beer, we don't have to replace it for it. Of course, Americans and Australians and Brits have replaced it in life. So when you see the email from there, you can say hi and your name. Now, in our culture, we still use beer. Secondly, please use dear, followed by the first name. So you can call me Shiva, so you like dear Shiva. Who looks scruffy? Yeah? Would you like to go to a hotel and pay top dollar where the waiter hasn't showered or shaved? Would you like to go to a restaurant and pay a lot of money? Or a hospital and pay a lot of money to a doctor who doesn't believe in cutting his nails? Would you? Now, I am all for Mark Zuckerberg. I think the guy is a marketing genius. Because when Facebook was launched a decade ago, first of all, the guy is a Harvard dropout. So let's not make any question of the guy's IQ. Right? Because he needed a dropout, but don't forget one thing, he got it. That's more critical. Right? So he didn't give it and he didn't drop out. So that's an essential ingredient. Now, so he's brilliant. And when Facebook was launched, what was the audience for Facebook? Who was the audience for Tamil group for Facebook?
College-going kids.
College-going kids. It was almost like a dating networking app. So you could keep tabs on each other. You could figure out who's who. You could make virtual friends. And you could actually snoop into their life. So it was an excellent app for somebody who was anything from 16 to 22 years old. And that was the audience for Facebook. Now Zuckerberg is a marketing genius. He really looks like a college going student. Am I right? See, he wears those goodies. Yeah? He wears jeans which have never seen the inside of a washing machine. They are falling off his body. They are dirty. They are filthy. They are scruffy. He never cuts his toenails. If you ever see his toenails are slipping out of that, you know those floaters that he wears with a hoodie on top. And all his money came at that stage because he really was marketing to the audience, which is college students who don't like to bathe, who don't like to shave, who don't like to cut their nails, who don't like to wash their clothes. So he is a marketing genius. But please Google Zuckerberg on two occasions. One, when Barack Obama visited the Palo Alto headquarters of Facebook. Two, when Mr. Modi went to his headquarters. Both times, Zuckerberg was in a $4,000 Kanami suit and a $500 bag. So Zuckerberg also knows when to dress up and when to dress down. Lot of people get influenced by the Silicon Valley entrepreneurs. I think they are marketing geniuses as well. If you are Steve Jobs, you wear that same $200 cashmere turtleneck, $500 diesel jeans, and handmade glasses. It's a wonderful look. But before you go out and cultivate the look, please make a business or make a name for yourself. Then comes the look. What comes first? The egg or the chicken? Who knows? Right? What are the other blunders that people make?
Because you have egg for the chicken.
He's saying chicken. How many of you need chicken?
I put egg.
He said egg. He's saying egg. How many of you feel egg? Okay, so you have only 2 minutes of coaching. What do others think? 2 people said egg and 2 people said chicken. What about the other 84 people? What do they think?
Chicken is just
a good thing. Okay, this guy is going to either the biology. Okay, yes. What are the other, so we find your way back to grooming. What are the other others that people make? Yes. Hair color. Too much hair color does not work. What are the other blunders you notice people making? In school, stained clothes, 10 marks, skin marks, painting marks, to the minimum that you are representing for them. So please wash your clothes, iron your clothes, take good care of your clothes, and don't stay in it. And if you have stayed, then go on and get some better clothes. Or go online and figure out how to get rid of that stain. But don't walk around with clothes that are stained, clothes that have buttons missing, clothes that are unironed, with the body's lines still through them. What else? What are the other blunders that people commit?
Body odor.
We live in a very tropical country. And there are three odors that plague us. Foot odor, mouth odor, and body. I'm going to show you a slide which will help you appreciate personal space and then you can remove the odors too. Your parents, your siblings, your boyfriend, girlfriend, your very good friends, they're all coming to that zone. 2 to 4 feet is the professional zone. More than 4 feet is the public zone. Now the 2 to 4 feet is defined by culture. In densely populated cultures like India and China, business is done at 2 feet because we don't have space. In medium populated cultures like US, UK, Canada, Australia, business is done at 3 feet. In very thinly populated cultures like Scandinavian nations, business is done at 4 feet because they have a lot more space. Right? Now in our culture, we have completely compressed, compromised space. Because in our culture, there is no space. Right? If you sit in a public bus in India, where's the space? If you go by local train, where's the space? Even if you go by an aircraft, where's the space? That they want to take all the people in an aircraft and one bus only. They don't like to get a second bus up. So in which case they decide to put 300 people in the same bus. Have you ever gone from the bus to the aircraft? Yeah? 300 people. I mean, short people like me are at a complete disadvantage because of the fact that you're constantly in some guy's armpit. You know, it's more than they can tell you. So there's foot odor, there's mouth odor, there's body odor. The problem with body odor is that even your best friend will not tell you to stay. Because it's too personal and you're all upset. So please do a self-test. When you go home, please smell the armpits of your clothes because that's what other people have been smelling. And if you think it's repulsive and gross, then let me tell you one thing. Multiple products which are available in our country, which are antiperspirant deodorant. You can use a lot of natural products. You can also use blue tube showers and that. But please make sure that you don't have water because it's repulsive. We work in very close proximity. And the worst is when we switch on air conditioning. Because then all odors get trapped inside that room and there is no way that people can escape. And nobody is going to tell you that you stay. Second is mouth odor. Onion, garlic, all extra toppings on your pizza, good smell. Please give them for the weekend. Offer you so that you can brush your teeth and go to sleep. Secondly, please need some natural or even artificial non-expressions. So that when you speak to people, they are not repulsed by the smell. Third is food odor, especially in a human place like Mumbai and Pune, where because your feet smell, especially in Mumbai, when you take off those shoes or those socks, the whole grass is going to run out in this dust. But they can't, so they sit there inhaling those fumes. But the sad news is that you stay. So please do a self-test on foot odor, mouth odor, and body odor. What else bothers you? Do men wear perfume? Yes. Do women wear perfume? Yes. The perfume should not be your intimate zone, which is how many feet? So has Shikha come to office? Yeah, yeah. Have you smelled her in the elevator? So Shikha has got half a bottle of perfume on her body every morning. Yes, what else bothers you? Tell them, this is your one chance to tell all the things that bothers you about other people and your friends. This is an ideal platform to air out all your problems. Yes. Then don't number two, speak fearlessly.
Eating properly.
Eating?
Properly.
Eating properly.
Yeah.
You know, I've written this book, I'm going to give copies to the library, okay, which is on dining scale. But having said that, I'm going to leave you with the top, which is top 5 dining rooms and rooms. I do believe that 20 years ago, the reason why I wrote this book and become a bestseller is because I believe that 20 years ago, there were only 3 categories of Indians who knew how to eat well with a knife and fork. If you work on an armed force battle. Anybody here from the forces? So because of the environment there, you see other people eat, so you learn to eat well. Second is, if you went to a prestigious boarding school, so if you went to Doon, they taught you. Third is, if your father was the CEO of a large multinational company. So because of conferences, because you had membership to all the colonial clubs, like Pune Gymkhana or Mumbai Gymkhana. So you went there, you saw other people, you polished your day. There was no home category for you. But having said that, I can promise you one thing. How you eat with a knife and fork has become an essential career skill, because more than 50% of all business is done over a breakfast, lunch, or dinner. So, how you conduct yourself on a dinner date is important. I'm going to give you top 5 points. First one. Fork is a four-letter word, and so is left. All forks go in your left hand. Is that simple? Knife and spoon are 5-letter words, and so is right. All knives and spoons go in your right hand. Is that okay? Third, why does a napkin exist? Any idea? Is it to wipe your face? Is it to wipe your sweaty neck or arm? Is it to blow your nose? Is it to make it into a ball of orange tandoori chicken and chuck it on the table when you're done with the meal? Is it? So why does napkin exist? Is it to protect your clothes?
Yes.
Yeah? Is it to save dry cleaning bills? That can make it very easy for you. It's not the reason the napkin exists. It's not an adult bib. You know when you were babies, your mother gave you had a bib, so that you didn't dirty your party clothes? A napkin is not an adult bib. A napkin is going to dull the corners. So the cleaner, the better your diet is. When you eat something, your food accumulates it. When you drink something, you transfer your food particles to the cleaner. So to prevent that, before you sip something, it is well to transfer it. The cleaner your diet, the better your diet is. Then I'm going to teach you another rule, which is called the BMW rule. Very simple, it's a green car, alright? Don't forget it in a hurry. B for bread, N for meal, W for water and wine. The bread plate goes on your left. Okay, I think this is a great moment for us, because I feel that the world is very lean and is very skewed to right-handers. Do you believe that? Yeah? Do left-handers mean the world is for right-handers? Yeah, when you drive a car, the wheel is in your wrong hand. You can never use a potato peeler. You can never use a tin can opener because the whole world is geared up towards right handers. But this is the revenge of the left handers. Because now, finally, you get to eat in your hand. The food gets transferred in your mouth to the left. In the Indian style of dining, you eat in your right hand so the glass is kept in the left hand. In the continental style of dining, you eat with your left hand. So it's a mirror page. Any questions? Yes.
In the beginning of the talk, you started by saying that Americans don't care about what other people think. So then why are we talking about politics?
This is not American style of eating. This is continental style of eating. In fact, the Americans have aped it as well. They have copied it, but it originated from continental dining. And having said that, let me tell you one thing. I'm a very patriotic Indian. But I do believe that there are certain things in our culture which are super and certain things that we can not. So it's my job to make it easy for you to transition into the world of business. So this is not American method. It's
but
an international
method. This is the clothing.
Pardon? Speak
loud. The clothing styles, like the ties and other.
Yeah, why should we ape the American style? First of all, as I mentioned, it is an innovation. They are innovating, so they are leading. Now they have decided that business suit is the only way to do business. 90% of all business gets done in a business suit clothing. Now you are having things on an ideal garment for our weather. There is 44 degrees outside. away from business school. But do you have a choice? I do believe that Indians are very poor at marketing. We didn't market. Like I personally think that handshake is not an ideal form of greeting because there's too much physical contact. I do believe that Namaste is a wonderful and elegant place to humble way to greet people. But having said that, Indians do not market the Namaste. So 90% of all business starts and ends with a handshake. We are good at marketing everything. So now if you don't market, someone else is going to take that position. And they are very good at marketing. How many of you have traveled to any destination abroad where you went to see a place and then you looked at it and said, oh my god, I can't believe I spent so much money to see this junk? Any place you've seen in any part of the world, visiting somebody, seeing somebody, or even on television, have you seen? Then you look at it and say, oh my god, like I personally traveled to a place called Stonehenge. You know where that is? Oh my god, what a sham. How dare you make people travel there? First, strategically you placed rocks. How dare you? Have you seen the Taj Mahal on the other end? How many of you have not seen the Taj Mahal? Please see, it gives you goosebumps. It is so stunningly beautiful. It is so beautiful. And it is so huge. And it is so magnificent. But it is so under-marketed, right? But more people go to see the Stonehenge if they come to see the Taj Mahal. What is there in that Stonehenge? Four strategically placed stones that nobody knows the history of. Wow! Super! Right? So that is what it is. We are poor at marketing. We don't market. If you see the Eiffel Tower, the biggest shock that comes to you is the fact that it is awfully short. Very short. I thought it would be like really tall, towering over Paris City. No, half the buildings you can't even see it. Then what are we doing? So in which case in our culture, we don't market. So if you can go and market Indian culture, good luck to you. Till then, you'll have to follow the rules. Yes, any questions on that? Anything you've heard, read, seen? Can you speak to them out? Pull off the door. The purpose of all meetings is to meet and not to eat. Is that simple to remember? So don't go there and start focusing on the food. Thirdly, there is no sophisticated way to eat aloo paratha, dahi achar. There is no sophisticated way to eat a masala dosa or to eat puri bhaji or to eat chale bhatura. So in which case, eat things that are simple to me. Whenever I invite for a meal, whether it's a job interview or a contract, eat things that are simple to eat so that you can focus on the conversation and not focus on making mistakes. Any questions? Are you done? Yes, we have a couple of minutes now. Two final questions. Kalamri, Ranjava, yeah? Is this your graduate? Yeah? Just tell me, what time did you go to school? 8. We had a short break and had a snack. But am I guilty of keeping 80 hungry children here, teaching them about dieting? Okay, super. Thank you, you've been wonderful audience.